Chris. Hope you're doing well, and welcome back to Popcorn Finance, where we discuss finance and about the time it takes to make a bag of popcorn. Today, we're picking up with part two of my conversation with the hosts of the My Biz Bestie podcast, Amber Hawley and Maelisa Hall. And in part one, we started our conversation about the way our personality types, and more specifically, our Myers-Briggs type indicator, how that relates to the way we deal with money. You know, on the episode, I shared that I am an INFP, and Amber and Maelisa are both ENFP. So we're really similar, just I'm an introvert, they're extroverts. Go check out part one. We'll talk about that a little bit more. But I really love the response I've been getting from you all so far in this episode. I've already got a ton of you reaching out to me and telling me what your personality type is. I had a great conversation with Holly over on Twitter, and she said that she is an ESFJ and her husband is an ISTP. Allison from Inspired Budgets, a former guest on the show, she said that she is an ESFJ. And my good friend Liz reached out. She said that she didn't remember what her personality type was. And that's okay. I probably wouldn't have remembered mine if I wouldn't have taken the screenshot of it, because I knew I was going to be talking about it on this podcast. My brother, he said that he is a campaigner, which I had to look that up. And that's an ENFP. I guess that's a lot of these personality types, Myers-Briggs types, they have like a title that goes along with it. So I guess campaigner is what goes along with an ENFP. Bethany Bayless, who you've heard recently on the podcast, she is an ESFJ. Elle said that she is an INFP. I know I liked her. You've heard her. She's a former guest as well. I knew I liked her for some reason. It's because our personalities are exactly alike, I guess. At Winning to Wealth said that he is an INTP. At Frugal Convert is an ENFJ. And at the Finance Femme, she is an ISTJ. So it's really cool seeing all these varying personality types. And, you know, as I look at what they're saying and I think about the people that I've met before, and you kind of can see the different traits that pop up in these personality types. So make sure you check out part one of this episode. It'll give you a little more background on the Myers-Briggs type indicator and probably help all these random letters I'm throwing out there make a lot more sense. Amber and Maelisa do a great job explaining it on their podcast as well. So if you go to the show notes, I have a link to episode 8 of the My Biz Bestie podcast, where they go over the whole Myers-Briggs type indicator in really great detail. And it made it so much clearer for me hearing them explain it. So I'm not going to mess it up and try to explain it myself. So for the rest of you listening, let me know, what is your personality type? What is your Myers-Briggs type indicator? You can send me a message on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. You can email it to me, questions@popcornfinance.com, whatever works for you. Love to hear from you. Let me know what your personality type is. So without further ado, let's jump into part two of my conversation with my biz besties, Maelisa and Amber.
Yeah, and it's funny because we're both ENFPs, right? And I do like having the budgeting thing, but I'm not as much of a spender, I would say. But compared to my husband, it's like, ooh, majorly different. But also, I will be more flexible with things. It's kind of like, oh, well, yeah, but we have the budget, but that's just our framework, right? Like, yeah. That is truly how I view having, like, it's a really strict budget, and that means it's a framework.
It's a suggestion.
So that means, we can take from this little section and then move it over here. Like, it's all the same thing. And to my husband, that's like, a little bit, maybe, but no, then that means the budget is wrong, right? You know, because we're not planning correctly if we're always changing it. Which I can see makes sense, but it's just a very different way to view it.
Essentially, Dave Ramsey's a J. Let me just put it that way. He is a he is like hardcore J.
He's just J-ing it up all over the internet.
He's J-ing it up. He is.
So for those people who kind of listen to this and they're like, okay, I think I'm a P, I think I'm a J, and they kind of filling out where they are, do you have any suggestions or what should someone do if they are I feel like I'm real far on one side and I want to make a change? Should they feel like they need to make a change? What do you think?
I think it's acceptance. I would recommend taking the test and finding out, because I think when you read it, you realize this is who I am. So it's easier to ride a horse in the direction it's already going. So sometimes it's just making, giving acceptance to that. But if there's something that's causing you distress, behaviorally, perhaps going out and finding shiny objects at the mall, maybe you can make a behavioral change. But at the same time, personality is pretty, that continues. But it makes it harder to make those changes. But absolutely, anyone can make behavior changes.
Yeah, and I think it also, I think it makes a big impact in thinking about how you divide up tasks at home, if you're a couple, especially, if you're a couple living together. And then also how you're happy with your job. whether you have your own business or whether you work at a job, you think about, like, if you're a P and you're an accountant, how do those things match together well? They could match together well, but that, I think it depends on what type of place you work, right?
Okay.
And how much flexibility is there, and do you feel like you have, I don't know, like some autonomy. Yeah. And then in your relationship, it's like, well, maybe this person is really good at this, so accept that. And maybe, you know, you can divvy up tasks in that way. It doesn't mean that you use it as a way to shirk off responsibility. But why not play to one another's strengths? There can be a huge benefit to having two people that are very different in that way. But that's where Amber, being a marriage therapist, comes in, because to do that, you really have to get good at communicating with one another.
Mm. Yeah, and I think that's the key. Because I swear, people always find their opposite. It's like, I always find the health food person and the junk food addict marry each other. I'm like, did you not date?
Yeah, and that's definitely true. Because for me and my wife, that's like our thing. I'm a little more go with the flow. And then she's a little more, you know, on it. Like, this is what she has expectations, and this is what, you know, if it's outside of that, then it's like, hey, yeah. This is
I
not
call
the
it structured, because it's a nicer way of saying, you know, instead of like anal or
you see, I didn't say that.
I know, because you're a smart man. He's a happily married man right there. But structured versus flexible, I guess, is what we would say.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think the key there is also, whether it's at work or in your relationship, recognizing that because you're significant other might be different than you, or your boss might be different than you, like seeing the value in that too. You know, enjoy your own strengths, but then see the value of the people who balance you out.
Yeah. And I will say, my experience is the J's tend to feel like their way is the right way and that the P needs to get on board. But I'm going to disagree, because I do think we offer value and growth in each other in that balance. But yeah, it's all about how do you communicate. And as long as you understand, different is not bad. Mm. It's just different.
I like that, because I know for me that's sometimes hard, because it's like I feel like, you know, I think this is the right way. I think this is the way the way we should do things. And it's just because I get stuck in, you know, I understand things a certain way. And I think that's, you know, OK, this makes sense. But some other way, maybe it's like it's so foreign. I can't follow along with it. So.
Well, of course. And it's your perspective. So the way that you view the world is the way that you interpret it as correct. So we all think we have the right way, but it's understanding, it's just our perspective. And we're looking through a certain lens, and our personality is that lens, right? Our life experience and our personality. So we always, I mean, I always feel I'm right, but and I know it's true, but but when you realize, no, it's just, that's my perspective, and the truth is somewhere in the middle, I think that's when people can be open to that communication and having a more collaborative, you know, dialogue and way of figuring things out.
And that makes sense too, because with me and my wife, for our finances, I think it was a struggle, because we didn't really communicate. We didn't know how to communicate. I know for me, I have a difficult time like communicating how I feel about the situation. So I think that just made me not want to communicate at all. So we would always constantly miss each other when it came to budgeting. And combine that with the fact that I think I'm right, it caused a lot of tension. And it's like hard to go back and forth between being flexible and strict. It's kind of like, you know, I don't know. I hope that's making sense. Like,
yeah.
And so for people, either if they're, you know, on their own trying to figure out how they should be dealing with money, if they're on either side of the spectrum, I guess you can say, or for couples, do you have any recommendations for, I guess, either communicating with each other when it comes to talking about money, or I guess communicating with yourself to kind of get yourself going? I don't know. Starting that dialogue with yourself or with the other person.
Well, I can say my husband and I, even though I had taken the Myers-Briggs and knew my personality, it was a few years ago that we both took it and then both read one another's descriptions, and that was hugely impactful for both of us, because we were both like, okay, it takes the thinking that the other person is doing something to you on purpose out of it, and say, oh, that's why they're doing this. And we both felt like we understood one another so much better. So just having that connect, I feel like that was the first step. Like, we needed that first, and then we could talk about things and have that new lens when we were talking to one another.
That's a great point.
Yeah, and that's why when I work with couples, I will almost always recommend that they take that test and then send me the results so we can talk about it. But when people read each other's profiles, then it's like, oh, yeah, like you said, it takes away like, oh, there's this malice in everything they're doing and they're intentionally trying to piss me off. And it's like,
yeah.
No, they're just coming from this mindset. And so I think I really recommend, whether you're in a couple or not, to take that test, because the more you know yourself and you can have acceptance, then it's like you can make changes based on behaviors you don't like or maybe like you're not living up to. But sometimes it's like, hey, this is who I am, so I'm gonna make this work for me. And you stop beating yourself up. Mm. And so so many of money is an emotional thing, right?
Yeah,
like
it
it's
is.
Not as much as people, much as the Jays like to say, it's logic based. It's very emotional. And so, you know, knowing that, like, okay, I am going to, you know, take in all this information and understand myself better, because when I stop beating myself up, then I'm going to stop being defensive, and it's easier to communicate when I'm not in a defensive space.
No, that's true. That's a great point. I like that. Two very insightful responses there. And, you know, for me and my wife, we both took the test, but we didn't take it together. And I don't think we read each other's results. And so we may have understood what each other, like what you're, I know what I'm feeling. She knows right. What she's feeling, but I'd never even thought that we probably should, I guess, look at each other's and then actually record it, because, you know, I don't know. It's I just completely skipped that part. So that's great advice. So thank you. I appreciate that.
Yes, definitely do that, because I think that could be really eye opening.
Well, thank you, both of you, for coming here and breaking this down, because I know I'm definitely not an expert on anything personality wise, relationship wise. So I appreciate the help and you kind of giving us some good examples. I think there's some good information that people can take and implement, and definitely go take the test.
Yes.
And understand yourself and your spouse if you're married or in a relationship and working with your money together. So I definitely appreciate it. So before we go, I already want to make sure everyone listens to your podcast, but is there anything you'd like to share with us that's going on? Anything new? Anything exciting?
Well, yeah, we do have a retreat coming up.
Oh, nice. Tell us more.
We are doing a Get Stuff Done retreat. It is for women only, because we'll all be in a house together. And the point is, if you're an entrepreneur, have a side hustle, if you have a business where you want to be able to get away and focus and not have to worry about anything else that you typically worry about and get one big task done, this is the place to do it, because everything will be taken care of for you. All you have to do is show up and work on your business.
In a beautiful house in La Jolla, just steps from the beach, and gourmet food and drink and everything, just pampered. So even if it's your full-time business, like we do, we escape our full-time business too. So definitely head on over to mybizbestie.com to get the information about the retreat, or to check out the full Myers-Briggs episode, which is episode 2008. I just upped our podcasting game right
there. Wow, you've been doing this for a very long time.
I'm an OG.
So what is the link again?
Episode 8. I'm so sorry. You're going to put it in the show notes,
okay,
right, my friend?
I will put a link to the Myers-Briggs episode, not 2008, episode 8, as well as a link to your the GSD retreat that you're doing.
Awesome.
And if that sounds familiar, you might have heard a little promo for the retreat on an episode in the past. So that's why I put it there, because I really like both of you.
Yeah.
And I think you do an amazing job. And I've already learned a lot from both of you just from meeting you and hanging out before.
I know. We adore you. We adore your podcast. We say Chris is our best biz bro that we have.
Yes.
We adore him.
We love Chris.
I'm happy to be adopted in. Thank you.
And I'm pretty sure, I don't know, this was at least a 5-bagger. I'm just saying.
At least. And not more. So I know you're trying to go for the record. So we were.
this is the bonus episode. The biggest, biggest episode.
I think you can have the record then for the longest episode.
Yes.
Thank you to both of you. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you.
Anytime. Big thanks again to Amber and Maelisa for joining me on the show. It's always so much fun getting to talk with them, especially in person. They're two extremely fun and funny people. And we actually got to record this episode together in person while we were all attending Podcast Movement, which is a conference for podcasters that was in Philadelphia earlier this year. So the GSD weekend getaway that they mentioned that happened in July, it's actually already passed. And I heard that it went really well. So if you want more information about the next time they're going to be holding one of these weekend getaways, or you just want to hear more from them, go check out their podcast, My Biz Bestie, or you can just go to mybizbestie.com. And I'll put a link to everything we talked about today and where you can find their podcast in the show notes. Just go to popcornfinance.com/86. And before we get out of here, we're just going to take a quick trip over to my pop corner and we're going to read a review that I got from DWoody22. And he said, awesome financial content. This podcast has a ton of useful information. Chris does a great job of simplifying what can be a confusing topic. This is one podcast you have to have in your library. So when double checked, and I did get a message from D. Woody. His actual name is Dan. So Dan, thank you so much for sending that review. And I really appreciate those kind words. And for any of you who are enjoying the show, you know, if you have a minute, if you have 30 seconds, pull out your phone, head over to Apple Podcasts if you're using an Apple device, and leave the show a review if you're enjoying it. I really appreciate it. I love the feedback. And it's always great to hear from you. Sometimes I'm sitting here on the mic by myself. Sometimes I'm at my desk. Sometimes I'm in a car, like I am right now, recording the outro to this podcast. And you know, sometimes I don't know if you're all enjoying the show, what you think. So getting to hear feedback like this is really great. It's really meaningful. I really appreciate it. So if you have some time, leave Popcorn Finance a review. I really appreciate it. And you know what? I appreciate all of you for coming back here and joining me for another bag of popcorn. I hope you have an amazing rest of your week, and I'll talk to you soon.
Your boy keep it popping like Mary Poppins.